Hi, good evening, everybody. So looks like I'm the only thing between you and the happy hour, so I'll try to keep it exciting. How many of you here have shipped or received a package from UPS? Please raise your hands. Yes, that's pretty much everybody in the room. So how many of you think of APIs when you hear the name UPS? I guess that's only me in the room. So today, I'm here to speak about our journey of shipping UPS APIs into production. Believe it or not, UPS has over hundreds of APIs, internal, external, and third party. We serve over 500 million transactions a day, and our external APIs receive over 300,000 unique customers. They serve over 300,000 unique customers. UPS is a fairly large technology company. We have around 5,000 IT employees. I want to repeat it because yesterday when I met somebody in the meetup, they were surprised that our IT department was that big. We do have 5,000 IT employees working on technology. I am Shobha Ramu. I'm the UPS API team engineering manager. A little bit about myself. I'm a proud UPSer. Originally from India, an engineer, settled and living in Atlanta, Georgia for the last 20 years, a busy mom with two lovely teenagers. So most of you here are associated with APIs. So I wanted to start the session with a good API quote. So I go to Google and search for API quotes, and instead of quotes, I actually receive actual APIs that you can integrate with to get quotes. Yeah, and the other day when my son was actually registering himself in Khan Academy for SAT prep, instead of asking him to give the SAT scores, previous SAT scores, Khan Academy just asked for College Board login credentials. And I'm there sitting with him thinking, okay, that's an API call from Khan Academy to College Board. And within minutes, they had the scores. So I just wanted to share this here so you know how important APIs are in today's IT economy. They're pretty much weaved into every business, and we have an API for everything you need. So this session is kind of in a good slot. I know it was a lot of energetic, informative sessions throughout the day talking about the future API stack. I have a story from a large enterprise API, and as we go through the slide, we can apply what we learned throughout the day. So today, mainly, I'll be covering characteristics of sticks of a large-scale enterprise API, evolution, how we evolved, and what we support today, backward compatibility, one of the most important things for us, and resilience, how to keep APIs resilient, and what's in the future, a quick peek of what's in the future. So I'm not sure how many of you are from a big enterprise. Some of the characteristics of a large enterprise API, basically, we are talking about a large scale usage, like billions of transactions, hundred thousands of customers, and hundreds of app server instances hosting your APIs. So the scale is very large. Backward compatibility is always a big thing. I know the Gail from eBay mentioned about it earlier in the presentation. Like, customers are very important for this enterprise APIs. We need to support a very diverse and geo-distributed customer base. Our customers are all over the place, and they come from all sorts and all shape. And we have a very high expectation around our uptime. Even the smallest glitch in our APIs are noticed by customers. So there's a lot of pressure for us to have our APIs up all the time. And of course, with any application, we need to be secure, compliant, and then respect the privacy regulation. And we need to support our existing APIs and continue to evolve. That's one of our key. So it's just a simple diagram for any development ecosystem in any enterprise. You see a backend assets, a company assets, which will be database of all forms, Couchbase, NoSQL, mainframe, EJBs, RMIs, all the backend assets, and front-end applications, which could be B2B customers who want to access your company data, or third-party developers who are actually building product that are integrated to your APIs and sell them in the market. And of course, your company, web application, bots, handheld devices, scalockers, scanners. So all these front-end applications talk to the company assets through the API layer. And in any mature company, this API layer is usually like a mix. They have internal, external, third party, and microservices, which is doing only one thing, or a big orchestration API, which is serving the complete use case as a one-stop shop for the customers. UPS has a similar architecture. We have API layers. Our APIs originally evolved as external APIs, where we provided a good access to a lot of B2B customers, big giant B2B customers, to ship through UPS, track UPS packages, rate a UPS shipment, or time in transit for UPS shipment. And then as the API mandate evolved, we kind of are seeing more and more APIs as an internal mechanism between two applications. Evolution, as you all know, APIs have been existing for a long time. The web APIs came into picture in 1990s. UPS introduced its first XML API in 1999. It was a plain XML over HTTPS. We initially started with DTD and moved to schema. And as SOAP became popular in 2000, we introduced our first SOAP API in 2002. Where we rewrote all our XML APIs as SOAP APIs. And we continue to support the XML APIs. The SOAP APIs came with a lot of heavy-duty approach with retry mechanism and inbuilt security. And then lately, we have introduced REST APIs and very flexible, better performance, lighter payload. And we continue to support all this multiple protocol because our customers are very important for us. And in the later slide, I kind of explain how we've made it very efficient supporting these multiple protocols. So I bet most of you recognize the movie Planet of Apes. I want to talk about three pointers or principles around API evolution. So we need to evolve kind of to stay ahead in technology to give all the customers the latest and greatest and ease of integration and incorporate the new features. At the same time, you want to be customer obsessed in the sense, make it easy on them, do not break them, and don't force them force unrealistic migrations on the customers. And evolution does not have to mean extinction. REST is the popular choice in the web APIs, but if SOAP is working and there's already an established contract between the customer and the client, the customer and the provider, it works. So legacy support is vital. So here's a classic example. I mean, I've taken the APIs, categorized it into three categories, and kind of put a simple diagram on how we can make it efficient. So the APIs which are distinct, like the REST API, SOAP, and XML APIs, which are very distinct, you can't do much. They serve the clients, you call the backends, get the data. Whereas the APIs, which have a lot of common business functionality and common business logic, what you can do is have an interface layer which is different, but basic object-oriented programming, like try to invest in refactoring the code and extract the implementation class for the common business logic, so you have only one implementation for that. This way, when business comes and asks you to enhance your APIs, just because you're supporting three API protocols, it's not three times the cost for your business. And there are certain APIs, even the interface level has some commonality, though they are REST and SOAP, there's some kind of mapping that can be easily done. So identify those APIs, and for those APIs, introduce like a transformation layer, like it could be a hand-built transformation with XSL, or you can have like all these gateways provide a nice way to transform. So in this example, I have SOAP API. If you're already supporting SOAP, you can put a gateway in front of it and expose a quick REST API as long as the mapping can be done. And if you already have an XML API, I refer them as POX API, you can go ahead and remove the code behind it and let it go through the gateway to transform it into a SOAP API. And there's another thing that I don't have in the diagram, but if you have an orchestration API for your clients and you want to go towards microservices, think about whether it's worth investing in rewriting that orchestration API to call the microservices as you write the microservice, right? I mean, in the sense, you don't have to have the microservice doing the same code that the orchestration layer, a part of that orchestration API is doing it. So basic object-oriented programming, basic coding concepts, but this is how you can make multiple API protocols work in a company and also have happy customers. Backward compatibility, this is one of the closest, dearest topic to my heart. We take it very seriously, so there are night before the releases, that's the main thing. We're always hoping that we are solid proof and we don't have any integration of or any customers broken. So I'm doing a simple analogy here of backward compatibility of driving an API truck. So that's an UPS truck there. So basically, when you're backward compatibility, it's almost like driving a truck. You're always looking forward through your windshield of what's ahead, introducing GraphQL, I mean, the new technology, adding new features to the existing APIs. But at the same time, you need to be constantly looking backwards and on the side view mirrors, especially when changing lanes, doing releases, to make sure you don't break anybody. So these are some principles that you can apply for backward compatibility to have a happy customer and a happy provider, both a win-win situation. You want to have a customer who is very happy. At the same time, you want to have your life sane. You don't have high maintaining things. So happy provider, it's okay to support a single version API. You don't have to, I mean, if you can creatively work it around and have a single version API, it is completely okay and it keeps your life simple. And if you do a multiple version APIs, think of adding the features only into the new version so the customers have an incentive to move to the new version. And when you version the APIs, think of maintenance cost because you need to visualize when your version will get deprecated and pay attention to the maintenance cost that will add for the future initiatives. And don't be surprised, you know your customers really well. If you don't know them well ahead, you will know them when you break them. So, and that's not a good position to be in. So you want to know your customers really well in the sense you want to log their data, of course, wipe all the sensitive data. You want to log their requests, log their HTTP headers. And as your testers and developers use that to test, basically as they test using interface testing and functionality test, use this production data to kind of test as well, because that will give you, you can do a before and after comparison and it will give you the confidence for the releases. Of course, we are talking about billions of transactions, so you can't run all the data tests, but intelligently pick the data and have that production-rich data run in your test environment. Happy consumer, actually that should have been the first because customers are most important, but I know most of us here are providers. Be backward compatible and do not version unless it's needed. Don't version just for the sake of versioning and have a deprecation strategy if you version. But in enterprise APIs, sometimes even though you have a deprecation strategy and if the customers are still using the old version and there is a feature that you have to add to bring dollars to your business, you go ahead and do that even in the deprecated version. And when you are shutting down the older version, be graceful, be gradual, give enough time for your customers. I mean, like, don't hurry, don't break them. And explain your deprecation and versioning strategy, of course, in the documentation. And with APIs, there are always mandatory changes that you will have to make, like the PCI changes, the security TLS changes. So those changes, you will have to clearly communicate to your customers and have a communication mechanism established. I was almost thinking whether to put this slide or not, but I went ahead and put this. It's more like a cheat sheet for backward compatibility or not. So just to summarize quickly, on the request side, any new validation or making an element required will break a customer. And on the response side, making the validation less stricter, like making a required element an optional, can break a customer because they're kind of expecting that element to come and it's no more coming. And adding a new element SOAP clients will break because of the WSDL integration. And for XML APIs, I think if they don't turn on the schema validation, they should be okay. And the REST APIs, it's a change in the behavior. So these are some four examples that I've given. It's just to get you thinking about backward compatibility. Things like sometimes which don't fit in the regular backward compatibility definition can also break the customer. Like you have defined a file name of character 50 characters, but then you've defined the format of the file name in your documentation. You want to increase that because of the uniqueness, but at the same time, I mean, you think it's okay because it's 50 characters, but just because you have defined the format, customers could be having logic around the format, parsing that format, or sending that file name into a database which is already defined in that format. So be mindful of those things. And even when you have not made an API change, if you're migrating the APIs to a new infrastructure, there could be a change in the API behavior which could affect your customers. For example, WebLogic to Tomcat, WebLogic, if you're not setting a character set, WebLogic's default character set is UTF-8, and Tomcat's default is ISO 8859. So there'll be a change in the behavior if you don't pay attention to before and after, not only to the body, but on the HTTP header as well. And again, in a similar example, when you're adding a gateway on an API that's very mature and serving customers, make sure the gateway is allowing all the HTTP headers that are allowed in the API today. Especially if your API is not very restrictive, make sure the gateway is allowing that. So have a before and after comparison. And another two small things, like in the regression, not only look at the HTTP header, I mean, not only look at the HTTP XML body, but also make sure the HTTP status and every single thing in the coming back in the HTTP header is kind of matched before and after. Because any change in those things will kind of impact the client integration. And the last one, I think we all know, error codes, changing the error codes will sometimes have an unexpected customer behavior. So if you can't make a backward compatible change and you think about versioning, some pointers about versioning. So for REST API, you can version through URI path, query parameters, custom headers, and content negotiation. For SOAP, you have the WSDL namespace versioning. And with WSDL namespace, be mindful because when you version using namespace, it creates two sets of request handlers, response handlers, and you will have those duplicate objects to maintain, especially if you don't have a clear deprecation strategy and you think that you have to support the version for a long time, you will have all those things to maintain, and it will add to the cost of your implementation, I mean maintenance. And you can have the version embedded in the XML body or the JSON body, and that's another creative way. And the third one is soft versioning. It's one of my favorite. So when you're adding response elements, you think you need to version, but if you pair it with something, like if it's coming as part of some changes in the request, so you can continue to do that because the assumption there is the client has used the latest WSDL to integrate to send the new request element. So that's an okay thing. Documentation, share the information about your versioning strategy to stop clients from building fragile integration. So if you think that you want the clients not to do schema validation, or share it in your documentation. So this will prevent them from building a fragile integration, and you can make changes on your side. And remove deprecated elements from your documentation. So if they have it, they will continue to use it even though you say it's deprecated. So please don't have anything deprecated in your documentation. If they need it, they'll come and find it, but you don't need to have that in your documentation. And the last one is a very important one. When you're writing a new API, visualize your future changes for your API. Like if some validation is going to be very important, don't miss that validation when you release your API for the first time. Because if you miss the boat for the first time, it's going to be really hard, and you have to add version to actually do that documentation, do that validation. So your first time API design should be soundproof. Take your time, discuss with business, add all your validation, and go from there. Another example there, like if you, for example, location type, if you have an element like called location type, and today there are four elements. think about the future. If it's, that's going to expand into 100 elements, then you don't want those four elements mentioned in your request or response as by the name, right? You want them as code values, so you have future expansion, so you don't have a huge request or response as these elements expand. Resilience. With the enterprise companies, like basically resilience is not important. I mean, it's not just for APIs, right? Every application has to be a resilient application. There's like several teams, like architecture team, there's network team, and there's a installation team. Everybody's thinking about resilient applications. There are plans for high availability. There are data centers, there are cloud. I mean, there's a lot of backup plans. So in this slide, I'm mainly talking about what, as an API developer, as an API product owner, as an API tester, or as an API team, what can you do to help build the resilience for an API for your enterprise on top of all the cookie cutter templates you already have coming as part of the enterprise. So when you, if you own an API, you are responsible kind of to make sure it's monitored end to end. Like if you're calling backends, even though the backends have their monitors, you need to make sure you have some monitoring mechanism. So in your code, you can actually, I know there are several tools that, awesome tools now to kind of dive into all the monitoring for each of your backend calls, but you can also add that in your code. Like if it's a Java API, think about JMX monitoring around your backend calls, trend the backend calls, the failures, so you have specific alerts coming. And so you're equipped when there's a production issue to know exactly what's happening. And trend your error codes, not just HTTP status. So even though 200 and the 400s are coming back, I mean, basically you want to know how your error codes look like, right? I mean, if your validation error has increased and if it's not increased just for one customer, it kind of shows that your API has broken somewhere, either you or some backend has added a new validation. So kind of have an idea so you can help during any production issues. And outside-in monitoring is very important. So you can have all the monitoring you want. You can have synthetic monitoring and the inline monitoring. But this will only work as long as the API, the hits are coming to you and you're processing. So you want to make sure you also know how you are looking from the outside world. Like have an outside-in monitoring, especially more geo-distributed monitoring to make sure you're monitoring it globally. And when you implement the APIs, think about, like, for every backend calls you make, think about, is this backend failure really going to mean that my API has to be down? So talk to the business, talk or discuss about that use case. So this way, like, some backend failures can even continue to give a partial response for API and keep your API uptime high. And you can give a warning and continue, and then the warning can alert and you can bring up that backend that's down. And when you build retry logic around any of your backends, make sure you build it intelligently, especially with APIs that are taking like high volume transactions. These retry can be devastating, like it can just add more stress to your application and the system. So have some intelligence built around for the retry mechanism. And rich logging is very important. Like you want to have in your API, identify anywhere you can have like a CPU intensive or a time intensive operations. Like for example, input output stream, reading the request, writing the response, calling a backends, and log the information of the time taken to do that. And I'm saying grep because ours is a Linux system, so be the grep master to kind of dice and slice these logs to have the information handy. And of course, there are monitoring tools that can give you these things, and on top of it, logging is such an easy thing that you can do to have a good log. And when there's an issue, you can pinpoint and help your APIs come back up right quickly. And performance test is a very important for a high-volume API. And with performance test, basically your projected volume is a key. So the projection, the volume projection is more like an art and a science combination. So work with your business, graph your previous growth, and have a good way to project your API volume. And every year, look at how close you came to your projected volume and performance test. Look for CPU, memory, the response time, and then the concurrent threads. and analyze it. And it's so much easier to analyze these things and look at it closely when you're not under the pressure of a production performance issue. With that, what's in the future for UPS APIs or technology? I can't give you a full solid list, but all I can say is UPS is like a 112-year-old company. I think I'm almost sure that we are the oldest company here. So we, in the immediate needs, we are looking into like doing microservices, gateway, and our APIs are evolving, exploring the new protocols. I can see that our UPS API's future, like basically need to support the future technology like drones, handheld devices with new technologies, scanners, lockers. I can see streaming APIs, open APIs, APIs around artificial intelligence to help our operations. I know it sounded like a lot of buzzwords, but that's where I can think of how our APIs are going to evolve. And last but not least, I want to just say that APIs are here to stay, and they will stay here for a long time and evolve. It's an API is a journey, not a destination. Everyone will start writing APIs and will continue to support existing APIs, and they are here to stay. And if you have any questions, you can reach me on LinkedIn. And thank you so much for providing me this opportunity to speak. So I think it's time for our happy hour now. Thank you.
Thank you, Shobha.